Good morning. Hey, just so you know, I'm looking at the clock on the back of the wall. It's the old time, so we got all day. Just joking with you. Got all day. But hey, we are so glad you're here with us. We're in week two of honor, our honor series. We're talking about how we can honor inward, upward, outward, right? And last week we talked about where is the honor? I mean, when you look at our world today and society today, we don't always honor people, treat people the way that we should. And we kind of stopped off with this point here that honor is decided, it's not deserved. That it's a choice, it's something that we have to make intentionally, each and every one of us. So today what I want us to look at for just a few moments is who do we honor? I mean, I think that's a question that we actually have, right? Who do we honor? Who are we supposed to honor? And what does God's word have to say about that? Now, let me just give you a misconception real quick about honor. I think a lot of times we limit honor to what you do or what somebody does or what we feel like we have to do. So think about it. We honor athletes for their achievements on the field, okay? We honor people for acts of valor, for acts of bravery. We honor people for breakthroughs or maybe for discoveries. And a lot of times we limit honor to just what you do. But how many of you know honor is more than that? Honor is about becoming. We want to become people of honor. Now, let me just say this up front because I think we need to understand something about God's word. It's alive. How many of you believe that? It's powerful. And something about God's word, like any other book, it's actually able to touch our soul. Now, you've discovered this before, maybe from reading your word through devotions or quiet time, or maybe even through a Sunday morning message. God just speaks to your soul, and it energizes you. It builds your faith. It encourages you. It gives you this belief that you can make it and that you can move forward. But how many of you know there are other times when God's word touches our soul, and it exposes us. And I don't know about you, but it's not very comfortable being exposed. And when we're exposed, we've got all different kinds of emotions. And one of the emotions is anger. And you know what I've noticed in my life? Sometimes when I get angry about something, it's because God has put his finger on something in my life. And he wants to help me overcome it, or he wants me to change. He wants me to put it behind me. And I'm saying this up front because when we talk about honor, I think we get all different kinds of emotions. And some of it is anger. And let me just remind you of something. You can give in to that anger, and by doing so, push God away. Or you can open your heart up to God and say, you know what, God, I'm here. I may not like it, I may not understand it, but I'm certainly teachable because I need help in my life. And so can we just pray for a moment? Because as we talk about this subject of honor, we want to do it in the right way, with the right attitude and heart, but we also want to be teachable today, that we leave here different than the way that we came in. How many of you know that's so important? And so would you pray with me just for a moment? God, we're here to honor you. We're here to use your word as a mirror to see who we really are and where we are in our journey with you. And so today, God, we pray for peace of mind and heart. We thank you, Lord, for joy. Even now as we receive your word and hear your word, we thank you for joy because we know that you're perfecting us. And you're finishing the work that you've started in our lives. And we glorify you for that. We honor you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, if you want to follow along today, I encourage you to grab your bulletin. We're going to look at a lot of different scriptures today. They'll be up on the screen. This is going to be a little bit more of a teaching. But again, I think it's important for us to understand, what does the Bible say about who do we honor? So we're ready today? You're leaning in? Good. I'm glad. Because here's the first thing we need to honor. We need to honor others. We need to honor others. How many of you know that we should treat others with respect and with honor? Now let's cut to the chase. Social media today makes it easy for us to be rude. It makes it easy for us to criticize people and to post negative comments. I mean, there's something about a computer screen that gives us the boldness to say something that we will not say to somebody face to face. Can I get two amens? Amen. And so social media can contribute to this idea that we don't honor people like we should. Now, how many of you know media also can desensitize us? You know, there are things that should concern us, bother us, get our attention, that they just don't anymore because we become desensitized. Now, I want you to understand a reason why. 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul writes this letter to Timothy, and he's talking about the end times. He's talking about this period of time between when Jesus left to go to heaven and he's coming back again. And he wants us to understand, what are some of the signs of the end times? What are some things that we need to be aware of and pay attention of? And so he starts off by saying this: you should know this. Another translation says, you should mark this, meaning this is a warning. This is something that you can take to the bank, okay? And notice what he goes on and says. He says, in the last days, there will be very difficult times. Now, another translation says that there will be terrible times. Now, let me just pause right there for a minute, because terrible, I don't know if that really gets our attention like it should. When Paul says difficult times or terrible times, what he actually means is there will be demonic days. Now, this is good. Paul's saying that there will be demonic days in the last days. And so he says, what do you look out for? What's kind of the number one sign that you're in the last days and that the enemy is trying to move with all of his force? And notice what he says. People will love only themselves. Wow. Wow. Again, God's word, right? Sometimes it hurts. Sometimes it exposes us. That sometimes we make ourselves the center of our world and the center of our universe. And Paul says that's not how you honor people. Because notice what else he says in Philippians. We're going a lot of scriptures today, but here's what he says. Don't be selfish. Don't make this life all about you. Don't try to impress others. He says, be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. So what's Paul saying here? Paul's saying that the way you honor people is by actually lowering yourself to serve others. That's how you honor. He's saying this, that it's others before self. It's a you first attitude, right? And let's be real today, because we in church. The church can be just as cruel and just as ugly as the world. And so here, we're going to build people up. We're going to encourage each other. We're going to honor each other. We are going to bless, hear me today, and not curse. We're going to honor others. Now notice what else God's word says. We honor others, but we also honor authority. How many of you are thankful for authority? I mean, I know I am. You know, without authority, there would be chaos and confusion and lawlessness and craziness, more so than there already is. And so I thank God for authority. Now, here's what you need to know about God. Two things. One is this. God is a God of authority. He is. Scripture says his name is above every name, that he has no equal. He has no comparison. Bible also says that at one day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord, that he is God. He is a God of authority. Now, here's what you and I need to understand, though. Second thing, God chooses to work in the structure of authority. So what that means is, if you want your life to be blessed, if you really want to experience all that God has for you, then you and I have to willingly place ourselves under authority. because that's where God works. And if you're wondering, Jesus taught this to his disciples. Because again, he understood about authority. You remember when he taught his disciples to pray, he said, "You pray, thy kingdom come." What was he saying? It starts with God. You honor God. God is a God of authority. You recognize that. But then elsewhere, he taught his disciples this. He said, when you pray, he said, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. And so you may be wondering sometimes, why do we pray in the name of Jesus? Well, very simple. There's power in the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, hell shakes and demons run in fear because Jesus' name has power and it has authority. But having said that, again, we have to willingly place ourselves under authority. Because get this, not only is the authority meant to kind of bless us and that's a place where God works, but how many of you know authority is meant to cover us? I don't know about you, but I need protection. I need a buffer. And so God has given us authority. But now as we look at Romans 13, Paul, in a sense, gives us some levels of authority. How many of you know there are different levels of authority? And he says this, everyone must submit to governing authorities, for all authority, now notice this, all authority, it comes from God, and those in positions of authority have been placed there by God. So anyone who rebels against authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and we don't like this word, but they will be punished. See, when you get outside of the covering, how many of you know there are consequences? And we know this, right? And so just quickly, not going to spend a lot of time on it, but different levels of authority, he mentions it first. There's government authority, right? And we know that comes at all levels. We're supposed to honor our leaders here in our community. We're supposed to honor our leaders in our state and in our nation. And as we talked about last week, attitude is critical when it comes to our leadership. And let me remind you something about attitude. It comes in two forms. There is nonverbal attitude. How many of you parents can relate to that? There's that nonverbal attitude. We roll our eyes. We fold our arms. We get a little bit cocky, whatever you want to say. There's that nonverbal attitude. But then how many of you know there's also a verbal attitude? And so let me just say this. Let's not come together today and worship God and experience his presence and then go home and bash people on our Facebook page. Oh, come on, I'm preaching this morning. Again, we don't have to agree with everybody, but let's not dishonor. Let's be people of honor. You know where else there's a level of authority? We'll combine these two, but there's the workplace and the school. How many of you know there's honor that needs to happen there as well? You know, when you're at the workplace or when you're at school or when you're at that teacher conference, parents, let's not talk bad about people. Let's not criticize. Let's not gossip. Let's not slander. Let's not disrespect people. You remember what God says about the workplace anyway? He says when you're there, you work for God, not for men. And so regardless of how people treat us or what they may think about us, we honor them because we want to honor God. At the school place, we want to honor people. I mean, my wife's not feeling well today. You can pray for her, but she's a teacher. She could tell you many stories of how parents came in and said things that they said. That's not honor somebody. Let's honor. Let's honor. And then you know the third level of authority is the family. And think about this. God created the family, didn't he? How many of you know family is a covering? Family in a lot of ways helps to keep us in check. Make sure that we live a life of honor. And I found this interesting that a couple years ago, they did a study. And they wanted to find out the correlation between children, families, and chores. So parents, you might want to hear this. This is pretty good. Here's what they found. They found out that when children only did chores that were self-serving, like clean their room or make their bed, that in general, the family unit didn't get along. There was fighting, there was arguing, and there was fussing. But they discovered that when children did chores that served others, like feed the dog, take out the garbage, shovel snow, cut the grass, do laundry, dishes, they found that in general, the family unit was stronger and that people treated each other better. You know why? Because honor is putting others before yourself. Honor is about serving. And here's the thing. Why is it that we let petty things push us away? You think about that in the family unit, right? How many families break down and they begin to fight and argue over petty things? And if you would ask them what they're fighting about, they probably couldn't even tell you. Let's not let petty things push us away. And you know, another thing I thought about, why is it that we honor people at their funeral, but not while they're alive? Oh, come on now, right? Let's stop taking our loved ones for granted. They're a blessing from God. They're a covering for us. And we need to show honor. And then the last one, I'm going to move on quickly from this because it may sound self-serving and it's not meant to be. But how many of you know their spiritual authority? Their spiritual authority. And you know, the scripture says that those who teach, those who preach, they're worthy of honor. And let me just say this from my heart. My wife, my daughter, we thank you guys for supporting us and for supporting the staff here, for partnering with us and serving alongside of us to make a difference in Oshkosh. And we thank you for that. We love you for that. But have you know there are some places where pastors are just treated as hirelings, and they're not really honored and they're not really respected. You know, let's honor each other. Let's honor authority. And here's a third thing. We're going quickly. But let's honor parents. Now, I'm not talking about like the parent-child relationship, all right? This could get a little bit fun. What I'm talking about is how we have allowed children to become the center of the family. You know where I'm going. It's like our family revolves around our kids. What their hobbies are, what their interests are, what their likes and what their dislikes are. I mean, you think about it. Even restaurants now, a lot of them are catered to kids. You go to Chuck E. Cheese and it's all about kids. Although I like to try to win the tickets too. But some of these restaurants, they have a play area for the kids. They have coloring sheets and activities for the kids. Now, we know kids are a blessing from God. They add so much life and so much energy to the family. But hear me, they were never meant to be at the center of the family. That's not right. That's not how God designed the family to be. And understand this, parents, I think you do. Some of you do, and I'm starting to wrap my head around this too. But your kids are going to leave one day. Your kids are going to leave one day. I started thinking of this the other day. I mean, my daughter's 7. And I started thinking, you know what? I might have 11 years left with her while she's at home. That's not a lot. I started thinking about that. You know, our kids are going to leave one day. And so you know what that means, mom, dad, husband, wife? You need to protect and honor your relationship with each other. Because you know what happens sometimes? You know this. You may have friends or coworkers that you know that have gone through this. There are a lot of families today that when their kids leave the house, the husband and wife look at each other as strangers. They don't know each other because they didn't protect their relationship. They didn't keep their marriage at the center of the family. And now they're thinking about, do we stay together? Do we split? What are we going to do? Well, how about we honor our spouse? How about we love our kids and we bless our kids, but we make sure our kids understand that our relationship as mom and dad and husband and wife, that's the center of the family. And we're going to make time for each other. We're going to spend time with you too, but we're going to work on our relationship because we want it to last. How many of you know that's honor? That's honor. And then you know who else we honor? We honor age. Thought I'd get a couple amens. We honor age. You know, Scripture talks about how gray hair is like a badge of honor, right? Look at what Leviticus says. Leviticus 19. It says, stand up in the presence of the elderly. Wow. Show respect for the aged. Fear God. I'm the Lord. It's talking about we honor age. That we give up our seat when they need a seat. That we let them go first when we're able to stand and wait our turn. Am I preaching today? Amen. That we learn to listen to their advice and what they have to say. That we honor age. But as I like to do, let me throw you a curveball. Those of you that are in this category, that have the gray hair, that have the life experience, that have a little more mileage than others, let me encourage you to do something. Let me encourage you to lead a life group with younger people. And Pastor Jody, right here in the front, wave your hand. She will help you get started. Because let me remind you something. Honor goes two ways. You want people to honor you, then you need to honor the generation that's behind you. We talked about this in our men's group on Friday, but God's word commands us to mentor the next generation. And so, if we have some of that life experience, why can't we come alongside some of this younger generation and say, you know what, I believe in you. Let me help you. Let me share some of my experiences with you because I want to see you succeed. I want to see you make it. Honor goes both ways. Notice what Job has to say. Job 12:12, it says, wisdom belongs to the aged. And understanding to the old. Young person, look up to somebody who's older than you and say, hey, can I talk to you about life? Can you tell me a little bit about marriage or about the job? Can you help me gain some wisdom in my life? We're going to honor age, right? And then you know what else we honor? We honor nature. We honor God's world creation, don't we? How many of you know that we should treat God's world with respect? Because God made it, first of all, but then he gave it to us to enjoy, to watch over it, to be good stewards of his creation. We should honor it. You've heard this said before, but protect, don't destroy. Notice what God says in Genesis chapter 1. He says this, then God blessed them. He talking about Adam and Eve. He said, God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and govern it, meaning honor it, steward it, take care of what I've given to you. Reign over the fish in the sea, all the fishermen say amen. The birds in the sky and all the animals that scurry along the ground. We honor nature. We honor creation. We don't worship it, but we worship the one who created it. And that leads me to this last point. Who do we honor? We honor God. We honor God. Listen to what Psalm has to say. Psalm 34, I believe it is, or 29. It says, honor the Lord for the glory of his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Psalm 34, come, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt, honor, lift up his name together. See, what we're doing today is we're honoring God. Now, let me just piggyback off something I said last week, because I think we just need to hear it again. I think sometimes we make God too small. We've allowed ourselves to become too familiar and too comfortable with God. God's name doesn't carry the weight that it deserves. Maybe I should go a step further and say Jesus' name doesn't carry the weight that it deserves. That how often do we hear people take the name of God and use it as a curse word? And use it in a way that does not bring honor to his name. We want to honor God. And you know what's amazing about Scripture? Is although Scripture has a lot of things to say about honor, when it comes to honoring God, there's really not a whole lot of specific things that it says. Did you know that? But there are two things that it does nail down. Two things that we can do to honor God. And the first thing's this. We honor God with our body. Did you know that? Your body was created by God. Scripture says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. That if we've repented of our sins and made Jesus the Lord of our life, that his presence lives inside of us. And so let me remind you, how you live your life, it matters a whole lot. And God wants us to honor him with the life, with the body that he's given to us. Let's not devalue it. Let's not disrespect it. Let's not abuse it. Let's use it in a way that would bring honor to God, but also let God work through our life so that we can minister to other people. So you honor God with your body, and you can do that research on your own. Scripture has a lot to say about how we can do that. And then, you know, last way we honor God, we honor him with our possessions. That we're just mindful of the fact that we have what we have because God's been good to us. He's blessed us. He's taken care of us and provided for our needs. And so we recognize the fact that what he's given to us, we want to use it in such a way that it brings glory to God, that it brings honor to his name, that it builds his kingdom. Notice what Proverbs has to say about this. It says this, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything that you produce. We use it to honor God. Now can I talk about the problem real quick and then we're going to pray? I think the problem is that we have made God a part of our life. How many of you know that's a problem? We've made him a part of our life, but we haven't placed God at the top of our life. And hear me today, if God's not at the top of our list, God's not at the top of your list, then he's not on your list. He's not. God wants us to honor him. And you know, we talk about salvation. And sometimes we throw that word around, and I don't know if we take time to really digest what that means. Did you know salvation, first of all, it's turning to God and saying, Lord, I repent of my sins. I change my mind. And I want to serve you. I want to follow you. I want to be a part of your kingdom and part of your family. But did you know what salvation really is? It's simply reprioritizing your life. Salvation is saying, God, I give you top priority in my life. That everything is about you. And everything is because of you. And no matter where I go, I am going to give you honor. I'm going to give you the best of what I have because you deserve nothing less. That's salvation. It's reprioritizing our life. I'm so glad we're here today. Can we just pause for a moment, bow our heads, take a moment and pray? Let the Lord speak to us today. And as you do that, where do you need to reprioritize your life? What is the Holy Spirit of God saying to you today right now about what you've heard? And understand, God brings things to our mind not so that we can know more, but he brings things to our mind so that he can make us more like Jesus, so that he can change us from the inside out, and how we respond in this moment, our attitude. It's so critical, so important. So as God whispers to you this morning, as he speaks to your heart, what's he asking you to do? Some of you, if you're like me, you might want to write it down so you don't forget. Well, let God speak to your heart right now. God, how can I honor those around me? How can I honor you? And I pray today, Lord, I thank you today for your presence here. I thank you for your word. That's just feeding our spirit and feeding our soul. God, your word is compared to a mirror. And it exposes us. It shows us what's really going on inside of us. God, I just believe today that you honor your word. And so you're speaking to hearts. You're whispering to people this morning. God, may they listen. May they act. May they respond to you. God, we're here to bring you glory and praise. We're here to lift up and to honor the name of Jesus. We are so thankful for everything that you have done for us. We are so thankful for the cross. But God, we're so thankful for the empty tomb. Because the tomb is empty, we have hope. We have life. We have forgiveness. So God, help us to honor you. Help us to honor others in our life. Let us honor upward, inward and outward, in Jesus' name.